Thank you. That concludes topical questions. The next item of business is a statement by Nicola Sturgeon on COVID-19 update. The First Minister will take questions at the end of her statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. And I call on Nicola Sturgeon, First Minister.
Many thanks, Presiding Officer. I will give a further update today on the latest COVID situation. I will provide an assessment of the current course of the pandemic in Scotland and, in light of that, confirm that there will be no immediate changes this week to the remaining, albeit fairly limited, COVID regulations that remain in force. I'll then give a reminder of the new arrangements for international travel, which took effect yesterday. And finally, I'll provide an update on the implementation of the COVID certification scheme so far, including the progress made in resolving the initial difficulties that many people experienced in accessing the COVID status app at the end of last week. Firstly, though, I'll report on today's statistics. 2,056 positive cases were reported yesterday, 10.3% of tests carried out. 998 people are currently in hospital with COVID, which is 3 fewer than the figure yesterday. And 65 people are receiving intensive care. That's 2 fewer than yesterday. Sadly, though, a further 21 deaths have been reported in the past 24 hours, and that takes the total number of deaths registered under this daily definition to 8,687. And, of course, my condolences yet again go to everyone who has lost a loved one. More positively, the vaccination programme continues apace and it is making good progress. 4,223,719 people have so far received a first dose, and 3,849,656 have now had both doses, and of course that means they are fully vaccinated. In total, 92% of the over 18 population is now fully vaccinated with 2 doses. That includes 96% of the over 40s, 75% of 30 to 39 year olds, and 64% of 18 to 29-year-olds. In addition to that, 72% of 16 and 17-year-olds and 26% so far of 12 to 15-year-olds have had a first dose. And, of course, for most people in these age groups, only a single dose is currently recommended. Most 12 to 15-year-olds only became eligible for the vaccine 2 weeks ago, and appointment letters were sent out to them last week. So the fact that more than a quarter in that age group have already received the vaccine is highly encouraging. I would again encourage all 12 to 15-year-olds and, of course, their parents and carers to read the online information about vaccination so that they can take an informed decision about getting the JAG. I'd also remind those in that age group and their parents and carers that there's also the option of asking further questions when attending an appointment, and I would encourage anyone with concerns to do so. I'm confident that our experienced vaccinators will be able to answer any questions and address any concerns. As I indicated last week, the programme of booster vaccinations is also underway. Those over 70 and those on the highest risk list are now receiving booster JAGs. People on the highest risk list who are immunosuppressed or immunocompromised are being invited separately for a third dose. Presiding Officer, this weekly update coincides with the latest 3-week review point for the remaining COVID regulations, and so I can confirm, indeed, as I indicated earlier, that at our meeting earlier today, the Cabinet agreed to continue in force with no immediate change the current regulations. That decision reflects, firstly, that the number of cases is continuing to fall, and so our judgment is that there is no need to introduce any tighter restrictions. But secondly, that the level of infection, though falling, does remain relatively high, and so that we consider that it is prudent at this stage, as we approach winter, to keep in place the remaining mitigations, face coverings, for example, for a further period. I'll give a bit more detail now of the trends we are seeing in cases and in the associated impacts. In the past 7 days, the number of cases has reduced by more than 1/5, and cases are now more than 60% lower than they were at the peak of this latest wave of infection back in early September. Although there are daily fluctuations, the trend in test positivity is also firmly downwards, from a peak of more than 13% in late August to just over 8% now. Significantly and positively, the fall in cases continues to be apparent across all age groups. The most significant decline this week again has been amongst 15 to 24-year-olds. Cases in that age group have fallen by almost 40% in the past 7 days and by more than 80% in the last 5 weeks. It's also worth highlighting that in the 0 to 14-year-old age group, which currently accounts for almost 30% of all new cases, there has nevertheless been a reduction of more than a fifth in the past week and of more than a half in the last 3 weeks. And that is important because although children are much less likely to fall seriously ill from COVID than older people, they can, of course, fall ill, and also they can and do pass on the infection to others who may be more vulnerable to serious illness. So this reduction is positive, though we should, of course, continue to guard against any complacency. The Advisory Subgroup on Education and Children's Issues is meeting this afternoon, and it will be considering the mitigations which are currently in place in schools, including the requirement to wear face coverings in class. It may well be that they recommend keeping the current mitigations in place for longer, given the risks of the winter period. However, should they advise that any easing is possible following the October half term, the government will consider this carefully and advise schools of any changes as soon as possible. Now, I speculated last week that the recent fall in cases is likely driven by two factors, and that remains our view this week. The first factor is an increasing level of immunity as a result of high vaccination rates and, albeit to a lesser extent, infection with the virus itself. This underlines again the critical importance of all of us getting vaccinated if we are eligible, and that includes, of course, getting a booster jab when invited. The second factor is our individual and collective behaviour, and I'm grateful once again to everyone who has taken extra care in recent weeks in an attempt to stop and then reverse the spike in cases. That includes the many businesses and other organisations who are continuing to implement and promote the basic mitigation measures that are still in place, such as face coverings, hand hygiene, good ventilation, and, where possible, continued home working. The significant and sustained fall in cases over recent weeks is now, I am very relieved to report, feeding through also into a fall in hospital admissions. In the second week of September, an average of 150 people a day were being admitted to hospital with COVID. That has now fallen by more than a third. At this point, fewer than 100 people a day are being admitted to hospital with COVID. As a result of the fall in hospital admissions, we are also now seeing a decline in hospital occupancy, which of course is the overall number of COVID patients in hospital at any given time. 2 weeks ago, there were 1,107 patients in hospital with the virus. Last week, that was 1,026, and today it is 998. In that time, the number of people in intensive care has also fallen from 94 to 65. Now, given that cases are continuing to fall, we hope and expect that the number of people in hospital will decline further, and indeed that rate of decline will pick up pace. And of course, we also expect and very much hope that the number of people dying from COVID will reduce as well, given the reduction in cases over recent weeks. All of this is positive, and it is a source of great relief, I am sure, to all of us. That said, the number of people in hospital with COVID now is still higher than it was in late August, and the pressure on our National Health Service remains intense. NHS staff continue to deal with the combined challenge of caring for significant numbers of COVID patients, preparing for wider winter pressures, and dealing with the backlog of care built up during the pandemic months. Also, as we head further into autumn and then winter, we do know that people will be meeting indoors more often or travelling by public transport rather than walking, for example, and that this will create the conditions for the virus to circulate. There is a risk that this will lead to a further rise in cases over the winter, and that would, of course, put further pressure on the NHS. So for all the improvement we have seen and indeed collectively helped to achieve, At least until we are well through the winter, we must remember that the overall position remains fragile and potentially still very challenging. That's why we continue to stress the importance of taking basic precautions, such as good ventilation, wearing face coverings and keeping a safe distance from others if possible. In short, it is vital that we all continue to be mindful of the virus and its likely presence around us as we go about our everyday lives. And in light of that, continue to behave in sensible ways that can reduce COVID's ability to spread from person to person. If we all do this, notwithstanding the welcome fact that we are all living lives that are much more normal than was the case this time last year or even earlier this year, but if we all continue to take these sensible precautions, we do stand a much better chance of keeping the number of cases and the associated pressure on the NHS under control, even as winter conditions kick in. Presiding Officer, there are two further issues I want to briefly cover today. Firstly, international travel. Proportionate travel restrictions will, of course, continue to be an important baseline measure to protect against COVID. They help reduce the risk of people coming into Scotland with the virus, but also help us to identify quickly any new variants of the virus. However, just as we have worked hard to get domestic life back to normal as much as possible, so too do we want, in an appropriately careful way, to bring greater normality back to international travel as well. Yesterday, the arrangements for international travel changed in Scotland and indeed across the UK. What were the green and amber lists have now been merged. This means that there are now only two categories of country: those on the so-called red list, which are, of course, the highest risk countries at any given time, and then, secondly, all other countries. Passengers travelling from countries that are not on the red list and who can show that they have been fully vaccinated or who are under the age of 18 no longer need to provide proof of a negative test result before they travel to Scotland. In addition, 18 countries, which includes Canada, Australia and New Zealand, have now been added to the list of countries whose vaccination programmes are recognised for purposes of travel to the UK. It is important to note, though, that despite the change of position on pre-departure testing, there is still a requirement at this stage for passengers to take a COVID test on the second day after their arrival here. This test must meet very high sensitivity standards, which means that in practice it is likely to be a PCR test. We're working with the UK Government on possible future changes to the position on post-arrival testing, but for now it remains the case that someone arriving in Scotland from outside the UK must take a PCR test or equivalent on day two after their arrival here. We will continue to work with the UK Government, the other devolved governments and the travel sector to ensure that the position on international travel is proportionate, that it is helping us guard against new variants and that as far as possible it is consistent across all four nations of the UK. The final point, Presiding Officer, I want to cover today is the COVID certification scheme. The scheme came into force as planned at 5 a.m. on Friday, although, as I set out last week, the enforcement provisions will not come into effect until the 18th of October. I'm grateful to all businesses, organisations and individuals who are working to implement the scheme. The app, which we can opt to use to show evidence of our vaccination status, became available for download last Thursday afternoon. I am, of course, well aware that many people found it extremely difficult to use the app initially. In particular, many found that the app was unable to locate their vaccination record from the information that they had provided. This problem was especially acute over Thursday evening and Friday. I know this caused extreme frustration for users who wanted to download the app as quickly as possible, and also for businesses and events organisers who were planning to test their certification arrangements over the weekend, and I apologise for that. The problem was not with the app itself, but with the NHS systems that it links to. Essentially, the high level of demand after the launch of the app, combined with an error in one part of the NHS system, meant that information wasn't being sent quickly enough from the NHS system to the app. This also, for a period, caused problems for those requesting paper copies of vaccination certificates or seeking to download a PDF. However, improvements to remedy the problem were made to the NHS system on Friday evening. Indeed, I can report that the initial backlog of people waiting for their information to be matched had been cleared by Saturday lunchtime. We will, of course, continue to monitor the performance of the app, and we will continue to engage with businesses and sectors subject to the requirement for COVID certification. In relation to football fixtures over the weekend just past, for example, while they had agreed that no fan would be turned away if they were unable to provide evidence of vaccination status, both Hearts and Rangers tested their certification arrangements and managed to check around 20% of their crowds. Scottish Government officials met yesterday with those clubs, together with Aberdeen, Celtic, Hibs and the managers of Hampden, to consider and learn any lessons from those weekend experiences. We're also continuing to engage with the other sectors required to implement certification. Presiding Officer, COVID certification remains, in the Scottish Government's view, a proportionate way of encouraging people to get vaccinated and also of helping large events and nighttime hospitality to keep operating during what will be a potentially very difficult winter. The scheme is now operational. The provisions are in place which require businesses to keep data safe and to use it only for certification. People are now able to access and use the proof required. In addition to getting the app, as many people have now been able to do, it is also possible to download a PDF or order a paper copy of a vaccination record from the NHS Inform website. And these will continue to be options for anyone who is not willing or able to use the app. As indicated last week, the first 2 weeks of the scheme will be a grace period in relation to enforcement, while businesses and users become accustomed to the new rules. However, during this period, we expect businesses to implement and test their approach to certification and to prepare their compliance plans so that they are fully prepared by 18th October. At that point, the regulations will become enforceable by local authority officers. These officers, as has been the case throughout the pandemic, will use what is called the 4Es approach. They will engage, explain, encourage, and only then, if those options are exhausted, will they enforce. In fact, their engagement work has already started. The Scottish Government also will continue to engage in the days and weeks ahead with businesses who are subject to the certification scheme, and I remain grateful to them for everything they are doing to help ensure that it works effectively. The final point I want to make is addressed to individuals rather than to businesses. There will be many of us who, at some point in the coming months, will want to attend a concert or go to a big football or rugby match or visit a nightclub or other late night venue. So I would encourage everyone to get a copy of their vaccination record as soon as they can, either through the app or by getting the PDF or a paper copy from NHS Inform. I know that the early experience of the app was not a good one, but it works now well, and the alternative options continue to be available too. Presiding Officer, in conclusion, overall, the position we are in now is much, much better than we had feared it might be at this time last month. Cases have more than halved in the last 4 weeks, and the number of people in hospital and intensive care is also now starting to decline. The efforts that have been made by so many over the past month in particular to step up compliance with mitigations and to drive up vaccination rates do seem to be working. However, as we head into autumn and then winter, we have no room for complacency. Cases are still high. Hundreds of people each week are still being admitted to hospital with COVID. And of course, the NHS is still under pressure. So we must seek to maintain the progress of the past few weeks. And of course, all of us have a part to play in doing that. So I'll close, as usual, with a reminder of the three things that we can all do to help protect each other. First, please do get vaccinated if you're eligible and you haven't done so yet. That remains the most important thing anybody can do. Second, please test regularly with lateral flow devices. These can be ordered through the NHS Inform website or collected from a local test site or pharmacy. If you test positive or are identified as a close contact or have symptoms, please self-isolate and book a PCR test. And third, please comply with the mitigations that are still in place for now. Wear face coverings in indoor public places, shops, public transport and moving about in hospitality settings. Wash hands and surfaces thoroughly and regularly. Meet outdoors if you can, although we all know that's getting increasingly difficult. So when you do meet indoors, open windows if you can, and try to keep a safe distance distance from people in other households. All of these precautions do still really matter. We can see that in the data being reported each day right now. They'll help protect you, protect other people, and crucially, they will also help to protect our National Health Service. So I would ask everybody to stick with it and let's get cases down even further.
Thank you. The First Minister will now take questions on the issues raised in her statement. I intend to allow around 40 minutes for questions, after which we'll move on to the next item of business. And I'd be grateful if members who wish to ask a question could press their request to speak buttons now. And I call Douglas Ross.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And I'd like to start on a positive. It is really encouraging to see case numbers, hospital admissions and intensive care admissions falling. But this positive direction of travel that we're seeing and the First Minister has announced in her statement raises even more questions about the justification for the SNP's vaccine passport scheme, a scheme that has been in utter shambles from day one. The app was delayed and only came into force less than 12 hours before the scheme began. It was instantly a disaster. People couldn't find the app. They couldn't get the app to open. There were issues with facial recognition. Even when people completed all of... Well, the Transport Minister is waving the app from the back of the chamber. Others tried to do this on Thursday and they were embarrassed a few hours later with the chaotic scenes we saw. Because people are messaging just now to say they are still putting in all of their details correctly and they cannot get their vaccine passport up on the app. So there are continue to be issues days on. There was no public information campaign. Businesses had absolutely no idea what they were supposed to do. Then we had the farcical scenes as one club after another across Scotland came out to say they wouldn't refuse fans entry because so many spectators had had problems with the scheme. What an avoidable own goal this was, First Minister. But in her statement today, what does the First Minister say? The scheme came into force as planned. So it turns out Nicola Sturgeon planned for this chaos. She planned for hundreds of thousands of people to try to download an app and fail. She planned for Scottish football clubs to ignore it. She planned for businesses to be up in arms. She planned for a scheme that was a shambles on day one. And it seems that the government didn't foresee the high demand over an app, that they wanted everyone who goes to gigs, everyone who goes to football, everyone who goes to nightclubs to download. Did they really not foresee the demand? And as the First Minister's statement just about acknowledges, it wasn't just about demand. There was an error with their system. Now she talks of a new approach, the four E's. First Minister, we don't need four E's to describe this scheme. We only need one. Embarrassment. A complete and utter embarrassment. So can the First Minister tell us, when the Scottish Government paid £600,000 of taxpayers' money to a Danish app developer, how many people were expected to try and download the app? Can the First Minister tell us how many people tried and failed to download the app? And to return to the same question I asked just hours before the scheme went live last week, will the First Minister now accept that the scheme wasn't ready to be launched and should have been delayed? And is it about time she listened to businesses and scrapped it altogether?
First Minister.
Before I address all of the points that Douglas Ross has made, can I just pick up on one? If Douglas Ross thinks that four E's is a new approach, then the only question that begs is where has he been for the past 18 months? Yeah. That's the approach the police, environmental health officers have been using day in and day out around all of the regulations that have been in place. So perhaps Douglas Ross might just want to reflect a little bit on that in future before he poses his questions. Let me take the substantive points, though. It is the case that we now have an extremely positive trend in terms of cases and all of the associated impacts that flow from COVID cases, hospital admissions, occupancy, intensive care, and hopefully we'll start to see a reduction in the number of people dying. That is really positive. When I was standing here a month, even 3 weeks ago, I would not have been entirely confident that that is the position we are in. And I understand that people will look at that and say, well, why do we need any mitigations or any restrictions to try to keep cases under control? So it's not an illegitimate question, but the answer is very clear. We do not know, no country does, what pressure we are going to be under over this coming winter from COVID. This is not the first winter we've lived through this pandemic, but it is the first winter where we will have COVID circulating and no lockdown restrictions in place in terms of our everyday lives. So it is prudent, in my view, I wish it wasn't necessary, but it is prudent to have in place proportionate steps so that we have the best possible chance of keeping cases under control, so that we don't have a health impact or people losing their lives or more pressure on the National Health Service, but also at the same time keeping our economy fully open and trading. That's why we're asking people to continue to wear face coverings, to do all of these other basic things that are really tedious for everybody but still important. And it is also why we consider, and we are far from the only country in this position, that COVID certification has a part to play. And that's why we think it is important to have this in place over these winter months. Now, the app didn't work as we intended it to do last week. There is no point me trying to say anything differently. I've tried to set out here as clearly as possible the technical reasons for that. It is deeply regrettable. But action was taken to resolve the issue. The issue, in essence, was the linkage between the app and the NHS systems. That action has been taken to address and resolve that. When we are in a position to, we will publish data around the app, the downloads, those successfully downloading the QR codes. But I can say, in terms of the position, this is a figure, and we rely on Google and Apple, of course, for some of the download information. But as of midnight on the 3rd of October, almost 380,000 people had downloaded the app. So we'll continue to monitor that, and we'll continue to publish information as we're in a position to do that robustly. And we'll continue to make sure that we have these proportionate mitigations in place. Because, Presiding Officer, if we don't, and I reflect again on a point I think I made last week, that if I cast my mind back to these statements going back probably months now, almost every mitigation that we've put forward to try to keep cases under control has been opposed by Douglas Ross and the Conservatives. We are not in a position of being able to do nothing in the face of this virus over the winter. So what we seek to do is the most proportionate things possible, and that is the action we will continue to take.
Anna Sarwar.
Presiding, can I start by sending my condolences to all those that have lost a loved one to COVID? The government's vaccine passport rollout is a complete shambles. Not my words, the words of those left to implement this chaotic scheme. Mike Grieve of the Nighttime Industries Association's words, nobody knows what is going on, confusion reigns, and we're stuck with trying to enforce this on the streets. His venue at the weekend was filled to a capacity of 410, but only 6 people attending had the new vaccine app. This was a predictable disaster, and it is the consequence of an arrogant government forcing through its ill-thought-through plans despite concerns from the public, public health experts and businesses. The promised app was rushed out last minute, and it crashed just minutes later. There are also severe equality issues here. The app requires a driving licence or a passport. Almost a third of Scots adults don't have a driving licence. Over 20% don't have a passport. And that figure is likely to be higher in the very communities that have higher levels of vaccine hesitancy. Not to mention the issues with digital exclusion, because you still need to go online to get the PDF. And now we discover that when thousands of people descend on Glasgow for COP26, they won't require a vaccine passport to attend. They will need to provide proof of a negative lateral flow test instead. First Minister, you are making this up as you go along. So will you either change or ditch this system? Finally, we all want to increase vaccine uptake. That should be the focus. So we should be making it easier for people to get the vaccine. So does the First Minister agree we should be opening more drop-in centres, more mobile centres, not closing them or reducing their hours?
First Minister.
As more and more people are vaccinated, of course health boards will change the configuration of the facilities they have available, but we will continue to ensure that the facilities are available across the country to allow access, as easy access as possible for vaccination. And I haven't got the figures in front of me for today, but I think certainly in the last few days, Scotland became the country of all four nations with the highest proportion of the adult population vaccinated. So, you know, the vaccination programme is a roaring success, but of course every single person that remains unvaccinated when they're eligible to be vaccinated is providing themselves with a vulnerability and adding to the overall vulnerability of the country. So we'll continue to make sure that we take those steps to get vaccination rates up as high as possible. Indeed, that is one of the reasons for vaccine certification, to provide that added incentive to get those vaccination rates as high as we can do. On the certification scheme, I've already made very clear I do not consider the experience of the launch of the app last week to be remotely satisfactory. We have taken action to resolve the initial problems. The app is working well. We will continue to monitor it. But on the issues of equity, and before I come on to that, the reason why we decided to leave a two-week gap between the legal requirement coming into force as planned at 5 a.m. on Friday and enforcement is to give the ability for individuals and businesses to test arrangements and get used to these rules. But on the equity issues, these are issues we've taken extremely seriously. But the reason why it is possible, if you don't want to use the app, as some people will not want to use an app, or if you are unable to use an app, if you are one of the people in the country who doesn't have a passport or a driving licence, that is why, as alternatives to the app, you can request a paper copy or download a PDF. So it's important that we continue to have those alternatives in place, and they will be in place for anybody who needs them. And finally, Presiding Officer, on COP26, we of course are working with the UK Government, with the United Nations, in terms of the overall mitigations in place around COP26, and there are arrangements around testing and other mitigations that those attending COP will be required to comply with. And these are arrangements in which we are cooperating with others. And I know all of us, for all sorts of reasons, want COP26 to be a success.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I heard the First Minister tell Douglas Ross that many other countries are adopting vaccine certification, but Scotland, we learned last week, is the only country in the whole of Europe to do so in isolation without the alternative of a lateral flow test verification. Presiding Officer, the Information Commissioner said last week that trust is key to the success of vaccine certification, and that people should be able to, and I quote, enjoy a night out without wondering if their data is at risk. Well, what little confidence existed crumbled on Thursday night. The launch was shambolic. Thousands of attempts to access COVID ID cards hit the buffers. Now, I warned that the government's IT system would not be up to the job when the First Minister first unveiled this. The government has had a litany of tech problems during and before the crisis. Once again, it cannot even get the very basics right. So is the First Minister confident that this scheme does enjoy public trust? And is there finally clear and practical guidance to support venues required to carry out these checks in accordance with the Information Commissioner's ruling?
First Minister.
Well, we have guidance in place for the sectors that are required to do COVID certification. As I said last week, as I said again today, the reason we have left the two-week gap between the introduction of the scheme and the enforcement provisions coming into force is to allow that testing and for that guidance to be properly applied and understood by the businesses requiring to undertake that. In terms of public confidence, I accept the point that Alec Cole-Hamilton has made, which is why the early experience of the app was deeply regrettable, but also why it was important that we quickly rectified that and continue to take steps to ensure that we monitor and rectify any issues that arise. I don't think the public, after 18 months of this pandemic, particularly want to be in a position of having any restrictions like this in place. But equally, I think, and certainly is my view from the interactions I have with people, is that there is a pragmatic understanding on the part of the majority of the public that we can't simply bury our heads in the sand over this virus as we go into winter, that we, if we want to live as normally as possible while keeping the virus under control, then there are some compromises we have to accept. And I think most people, in my experience, accept that COVID certification, I noticed on some of the media coverage on Thursday into Friday, actually the interviews and the vox pops that were being done were actually very pragmatic about the acceptance of showing vaccination status as, I suppose, an alternative to some of the more restrictive options. None of this is a position any of us want to be in. I wish, possibly more than most in this chamber, I wish we could just wash our hands of this virus and stop having to consider any of this. Stop having to deal with some of the headaches and the teething problems around the things that we have to introduce. We're doing this to try to get ourselves through a winter with COVID kept under control and the economy and our lives operating as normally as possible. Is that easy every single day for anybody? No, it's not. But I'm afraid it is essential while this virus continues to circulate as it is.
I call John Mason to be followed by Murdo Fraser.
Thank you very much. The furlough scheme has helped us through COVID, and yet COVID continues and the furlough scheme has stopped. Can the First Minister give her impression as to how this is going to impact on Scottish workers?
First Minister.
Well, I've got significant concerns. I know I'm not alone in this chamber in having these concerns about the impact of the withdrawal of furlough, while there is still an impact on the economy and businesses and workers more generally of the pandemic and what we're having to do to control it. So I think we will need to see over the weeks and months to come exactly what that impact is. I would expect that there will be an impact in terms of jobs lost. Of course, we also have acute labour shortages across our economy. So one of the things the Scottish Government is anxious to do is make sure that we are, through our Skills Development Agency and the other work we do around employability, is trying to match available skills with the job vacancies that are there. But we're going into a very uncertain period in terms of employment, in terms of labour shortages and the overall impact on the economy. I think it would have been preferable had furlough remained in place for longer, but of course that's not a decision that was at the hand of the Scottish Government.
Murdo Fraser to be followed by Christine Graham.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The First Minister in her statement mentioned the issue of face coverings in schools. I've had constituents who are parents asking me why their children have to continue wearing face masks in schools, even when seated at desks. When they saw the First Minister and many of her colleagues at the weekend on social media in this building, meeting members of the public, not themselves wearing face coverings or exercising any social distancing. And the question they are asking is there one rule for their children and a different rule for the First Minister and her colleagues?
First Minister.
No, there's no, and I think people know that. Many of Murdo Fraser's colleagues, and I'm very delighted about this, introduced me to their guests here on Saturday. There were moments where photographs were being taken in this building where face coverings were not on. That does not mean that the rules apply to one person and not to another. I don't want to be in a position of having to wear face coverings for longer than necessary, and I certainly don't want to be in a position of asking anybody else to do that. But this comes back to the central point. We can't simply pretend this virus doesn't exist. So what are the proportionate least restrictive measures we can take to keep it under control? And Murdo Fraser, I guess, is perhaps making the point that I was making to Douglas Ross. We know what the Conservatives don't want us to do in terms of mitigations. What we don't hear from them is how they do think we should keep this virus under control over the winter. In terms of schools, and many of us will have school-age relatives and friends, and if there was a setting in which I would like first and foremost to lift the requirement to wear face coverings, it is in the classroom, because it is far from ideal from young people. But we have to take advice. We have to listen to that advice. As I said earlier on, the advisory subgroup is meeting this afternoon and we'll await their latest advice and share it with Parliament in due course.
Christine Graham to be followed by Colin Smith.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. First Minister, I refer to your statement that the over 70s are now receiving booster jabs. Can I ask for clarification if the timing of that booster is dependent on when you receive the second vaccine, and indeed that you might then be offered your booster and flu jab on the one visit?
First Minister.
It is entirely possible. In fact, I know some people who are already in this category who will get their booster vaccine and their flu jab in the same visit, and where possible that will happen. There is a recommended time gap between the second vaccine and the booster vaccine. The JCVI set that out in their advice of 6 months, if memory serves me correctly, it is 6 months, and that will then guide the timing of booster vaccinations, which is why somebody in my age group will wait longer than somebody in my parents' age group for that booster vaccination. Those vaccinations are underway. Health and care staff, those over 70, those at the highest risk group are of course being given the booster vaccinations first, and then we'll work through the rest of the recommended population in the order they got their initial vaccination to take account of that recommended time gap.
Colin Smith to be followed by Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. A number of health boards, including NHS Lanarkshire and Dumfries and Galloway, don't currently have any drop-in clinics for COVID vaccinations and have returned to an appointment system at a time the government says it wants to boost the number of young people being vaccinated. Is the First Minister concerned this decision, no doubt due to staff shortages, will have an impact on a quick rollout of the booster and flu vaccine programme this autumn and winter?
First Minister.
Again, these are important issues. I would want to stress, though, that decisions that individual health boards are taking about the best way to deliver vaccinations as we get to the very high uptake levels that we're seeing now are not driven by staff shortages. They're driven by considerations of the most effective use of resources. So when we are at a point, as we are in many age groups, where there are relatively small numbers of people who are not yet vaccinated, drop-in clinics open all day may not be the most effective way to reach those people. Offering appointments are more effective. In bigger health board areas, that will be a different consideration. So this is simply about recognising the progress that has been made, the state of the situation right now, and how health boards are best placed to reach those who are not yet vaccinated. The percentages are small, but within those percentages there are still lots of people that we want to reach, so therefore it's important that we allow health boards to exercise some judgment and discretion given their different geographies of how best to reach these people. Of course, the Health Secretary stays very close to these discussions with all health boards.
Stephanie Callaghan to be followed by Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister what data the Scottish Government holds and the levels of public compliance with the mandatory wearing of face coverings in indoor public places and on public transport.
First Minister.
Well, we carry out regular surveys of public opinion, and in terms of the most recent surveys, which I think take us up to towards the end of September, I think over 80% of respondents agreed that wearing a face covering was either very or fairly important, and over 90% said that they were wearing face coverings when required to do so very or fairly well. So I think that illustrates the point that while I'm sure if you asked people to say whether they liked wearing face coverings or not, the numbers would be much, much lower. But I think there's a very pragmatic acceptance on the part of the public that certain mitigations are still required if we're to get through this next, hopefully final phase of the pandemic over the winter. And I think those numbers on face coverings demonstrate that.
Rachel Hamilton to be followed by Fulton McGregor.
Presiding Officer. My constituent recently wished to travel to Germany to see her family. However, she was unable to get a COVID passport and feels discriminated. Can the First Minister give the Chamber a progress update on the steps it has taken to improve transfer of international and cross-border data to enable people like my constituent, who received one vaccine in England and one vaccine in Scotland, to obtain proof of their vaccination status and access a vaccine passport?
First Minister.
I'm happy to write to the member and put more details of this in spice in order to keep my answer as brief as possible. In terms of the interoperability between England and Scotland, those issues have been addressed. We continue to add other countries. People from other countries can get proof of vaccination in their own country for use here. Obviously, I don't know the circumstances in which the member's constituent was unable to get a COVID passport, but if you want to pass those details to me, I'm happy to have that looked into. But what I'll undertake to do, Presiding Officer, is set out for Spice the different categories of people who live here who might have been vaccinated somewhere else, or visitors here, and what the current arrangements are in terms of accessing the status of vaccination.
Fulton McGregor to be followed by Ross Greer.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The First Minister might be aware that the United Dance Organisation's European and World Dance qualifiers required to be held in November and December, or Scottish dancers will not be able to take part. To date, my constituent, Michelle Connolly, the designated organiser of the Scottish qualifiers, has been unable to secure a suitable venue, as all councils across central Scotland are telling her that it is out with the current COVID guidance, as the event requires an attendance of up to 2,000. I can send the First Minister's office more information if required, but I wonder if the First Minister could investigate this issue and ensure appropriate guidance is issued to local authorities to allow these talented young people the opportunity to join their counterparts from countries across the globe and to represent Scotland on the world stage.
First Minister.
I'm more than happy if Philip McGregor wants to send me details of this to look into it further and issue whatever guidance we may deem necessary as a result of that. I would remind the Chamber, though, that there are currently no limits on the size of events that can take place in Scotland as a result of COVID rules. Of course, certain events over a certain number of people, which varies whether based on whether the events are indoors or outdoors, will be subject to COVID certification. But I think last week I set out the fact that because of the introduction of COVID certification, the rules around needing permission for size of certain events were being removed. So there is no overall limit on the size of events that can take place.
Ross Greer to be followed by Karen Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Next week is the deadline for ventilation improvements in Scottish schools. Could the First Minister provide the Chamber with an update on how much of the funding allocated for these improvements has been spent, if a report will be produced on how it was spent, and what measures are in place to monitor the effectiveness of the improvements that were made?
First Minister.
Well, the announcement of the £25 million fund to support small businesses enhance ventilation, I think we made that announcement at the end of September, it has been very warmly welcomed by a number of stakeholders, including the Federation of Small Businesses. Since making that announcement, as I indicated we would, we've been working with delivery partners to take forward the next steps, recognising the importance of this work as we enter the winter months when it might be less practical for businesses to keep windows and vents open. So we will set out the further details of the grant and funding scheme. And of course, we will report, as we have done against previous funding streams for businesses, we will report against uptake and spend around that particular fund.
Karen Adam to be followed by Rona Mackay.
To ask the First Minister what reassurances the Scottish Government can provide for people with medical exemption from the COVID-19 vaccine, that they will be treated with dignity and respect as we transition to the full vaccine passport programme.
First Minister.
Well, there are a very, and I stress a very small number of people in Scotland who cannot be vaccinated for medical reasons. There may be people who believe that they cannot be vaccinated for medical reasons, but actually in very few cases will that turn out to be the case. However, medical exemptions allow those who can't be vaccinated due to a health condition access to settings that would otherwise require vaccination, and people that are known to health boards to be in that category are being notified of that. And of course, over a period, it will also be possible for people who think they are in that category and haven't had that notification to apply for it. It is important that people in this position are treated with kindness and with dignity and with understanding. But I want to stress again that there are actually very, very small numbers of people who cannot be vaccinated for health reasons.
Rona Mackay to be followed by Tess White.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Recently, I was contacted by a constituent who was a participant in the Novavax COVID vaccine trials. The vaccine is yet to be approved, but my constituent has been unable to access her vaccination status via the app and hasn't been issued with a QR code within her vaccination letter. Can the First Minister outline what support is available for trial participants to ensure they're not disadvantaged during the rollout of the certification programme?
First Minister.
Work is ongoing, I think I covered this in response to a question last week, to ensure that the vaccine status of those who volunteer for clinical trials is correctly presented on the vaccine database. A letter confirming someone's involvement in trials has been issued to those who participated in the trials, and any participant who's not yet received a letter should contact their respective research team. That letter can be used for domestic purposes as proof of trial status. Individuals travelling abroad will still need to meet the requirements of their destination country when travelling, for example, a negative pre-departure test, if that is the arrangements and if that is stipulated by the respective country. But I'd stress that anybody here who took part in a trial will not be disadvantaged. That would be deeply unfair given the great service they have done to the rest of us. They should have had a letter, and if they haven't had a letter, they should contact their respective research team.
Tess White to be followed by Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Head of Health Intelligence for NHS Grampian commented last week that there's been a reduction in lateral flow testing, with many people only using these tests once they become symptomatic. What action is the Scottish Government taking to ensure the public is aware of the clinical guidance on lateral flow tests and to encourage its uptake?
First Minister.
Well, we are taking a range of steps and have been for some time now to encourage people to use lateral flow devices, to ideally use them twice a week. There are particular groups that we give particular advice to, you know, people, pupils and staff in secondary schools, for example. Every time I stand here, I remind people about the importance of using lateral flow devices. The importance of LFD testing has featured in a lot of our marketing and advertising campaign around COVID, and so we'll continue to encourage people. I think it stands to reason that when cases rise, people, because understandably, are more anxious, are possibly likely to do it more. When cases fall again, there may be a tendency to fall back in that. And that's why a really important message for me, for the government, but actually for all of us to give is don't drop your guard as cases continue to fall. It's still important that we do all of these things to stop them rising again. And testing yourself with LFD devices is one important way of doing that.
Emma Harper, to be followed by Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Just on the back of Tess White's question, around one in three people with COVID-19 do not have symptoms but can still infect others. And particularly as we head into winter and the likelihood of people gathering indoors, I'm sure the First Minister will want to reiterate how important it is for people to take rapid lateral flow tests every 3 to 4 days to check for COVID-19, even if folk don't have symptoms. But can she confirm that these tests will still remain free of charge in Scotland?
First Minister.
We absolutely intend that these tests remain free of charge. They're an important part of our protection against COVID. Emma Harper is right. There are a significant number of people who will contract COVID who don't display symptoms and certainly don't display symptoms in the early part of their period of infection. That's why lateral flow testing is so important. Our advice is to do it twice a week. I would also advise people to do that, and in addition to do that before you perhaps go somewhere, or if you forget to do it once or twice a week, do it if you're due to visit somebody or go to a particular event. The other part of the advice, of course, is if your LFD is positive, then make sure you book a PCR test to get confirmation of that result and, of course, isolate immediately. It is really important that we all continue to do these things over the winter. And if we all do follow all of this advice, we do have the best chance of keeping cases on a downward track.
Paul Sweeney, to be followed by Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As Mr Sarwar previously mentioned, a third of Scots don't have a driver's licence and a quarter of Scots don't have a passport. Given these are integral to the app, logging in to this app, is there a potential digital exclusion issue there with the design of the app? And can the First Minister agree that that perhaps indicates design immaturity in the app, and will she take steps to address that potential flaw in the system?
First Minister.
Well, we have addressed the fact that not everybody will have a driving licence or a passport and therefore will not be able to use the app. That is why, not just for a few days, but throughout this, we intend to continue to offer the alternatives of somebody being able to order a paper copy of their vaccination status or download a PDF. So both of those things can be done without using the app at all. And it's important that those alternatives are there and people are aware of them.
Jim Fairley, to be followed by Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We're all aware of how difficult things have been during the pandemic and with the restrictions and the need for a good recovery. But businesses across my constituency have been impacted by the 7.5% rise in VAT, which the UK government imposed at the start of October. This is in addition to the pressures caused by rising wages and rising inflation. Indeed, Douglas Ross said in First Minister's questions last week that businesses have never had a tougher time than right now. And given that many hospitality businesses in my constituency are reporting they did not experience the staycation bounce this year, does the First Minister agree with me that the supposed party of business in this chamber should speak to colleagues in London about the impact these VAT changes are having on businesses in Scotland?
First Minister.
It would be good if occasionally the Scottish Conservatives raised any of these concerns with their counterparts in London. I'm not convinced their counterparts in London pay any attention to them, incidentally, but that's another matter altogether. But there's a really serious issue at the heart of this. The Tories are right now raising taxes on businesses and on individuals at a really difficult time for the economy as we try to recover from this pandemic. Brexit has also caused, as we know, acute labour shortages across our economy, which is making it difficult to get certain foodstuffs to supermarket shelves. It's making it difficult for people to access fuel reliably. And these problems, I think, are going to simply increase and get worse over the winter unless the UK government really stops and thinks about the impact of its actions and comes up with solutions. And I think all of us should be demanding that they come up with solutions and come up with these solutions quickly.
Alexander Stewart to be followed by Willie Coffey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. With reports this morning that police officers are now routinely filling in for ambulance crews by transporting patients to hospital, does the First Minister accept that this government waited too long to tackle the crisis in the ambulance service?
First Minister.
The police are not routinely filling in for the ambulance service. The Scottish Ambulance Service has not asked the police to take patients to hospital. Of course, it may well be, and I'm not sure if the member is suggesting that this shouldn't be the case, that if a police officer comes across somebody who needs to go to hospital, they will opt to transfer them to hospital without. But that is not as a result of a request from the Scottish Ambulance Service. We have big challenges across our ambulance service and our National Health Service, just as England, Wales and Northern Ireland and many countries across the world do. We are taking action to respond to these challenges. We are rightly and properly, and this will continue, I'm sure, throughout the winter, being robustly scrutinised on that. But let's not sort of claim that things are happening that are not happening across the country.
Willie Coffey to be followed by Graeme Simpson.
Thank you. Can I ask the First Minister whether the Scottish Government is aware of reports of some families being prevented from travelling abroad because their teenage children may still test positive for COVID many weeks after their first positive test, despite no longer being infectious, and to ask what can be done to remedy this situation with the school holiday period almost upon us?
First Minister.
We do recognise, and obviously this is a clinical reality, that someone who has recently had COVID may continue to test positive for some time, and depending on the rules in countries to which they are travelling, that could prevent them from travelling. So people need to check the entry requirements for countries they're planning to visit before arranging a trip. This is one of these issues where we will, you know, look on an ongoing basis at things we can do to try to ease the difficulties that are being caused here, but it is just one of these features of COVID that people have to think about when they're making decisions about travel or indeed making decisions about doing things here.
And Graeme Simpson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee earlier today rejected the government's vaccine passport regulations on the basis that they were rammed through without proper parliamentary scrutiny. There's been ample time to show Parliament the respect it deserves and allow MSPs to scrutinise this deeply flawed scheme before it came into force. So given that a committee has now said, hold on a minute, will the First Minister agree to rescind the regulations so that MSPs can do our job?
First Minister.
Well, no, I won't agree to do that. I'll agree to follow the process that is actually in place for this eventuality. I'm sure the member knows, I'm absolutely convinced he knows, that in these circumstances what has to happen is that within 28 days the regulations have to come for a decision of the whole Parliament. So that is what will happen, and I'm sure all MSPs of all parties will fully and properly do their jobs.
Thank you. That concludes the First Minister's statement, COVID-19 update. There will be a short suspension before we move on to the next item of business.